I will introduce the third speaker, who is Dr. Chandika Epitakaduwa. He is the acting consultant in histopathology at the teaching hospital Anuradhapura and a lecturer at the Faculty of Medicine, Rajaratnam University. Dr. Epitakaduwa will be speaking on the topic, from laboratory point of view, what do you expect from interns? Over to you, Dr. Epitakaduwa.
Thank you very much, distinguished chairperson, my co-speakers, and dear new doctors who will be joining the service in a couple of weeks' time, and Dr. Hewage, Ratnasiri Hewage, who talked on the same topic, described you the points which he has to highlight on the point of an administrator and maybe a clinician. But this is the point of view which the pathologist and the hematologist and the microbiologist, that means the laboratory set of people, are having with regards to effective use of hospital laboratory services. So in a few weeks' time, you are going to be a very busy person like this. So you will be having more than one work to do at the given time. But you will be basically set up in the ward setting. So somebody can come and ask what the pathologist have got to do with the people who are in the clinical setup. Is this interest is pathological? Somebody may ask. But the answer you will be having in a short while, the answer is your work is reflected by our report. So in the clinical setup, you take clinical decisions. After that, you write a sample which it should be investigated at the laboratory. And after that, you are doing sample collection and labeling is done. After that, storing of the sample until it is transported to the lab. After that, it will be transported. So this phase is called as the pre-analytical phase of the laboratory investigations. And after that, it will be analyzed in the laboratory after following so many laboratory procedures. And after that, reporting and clinical validation of the sample, report will be done. This phase is called as the analytical phase. After that, what happens is the report will be printed and it will be sent for report collection. This is the post-analytical phase. So if you can understand these three phases, the majority or the bulk of the procedure is totally dependent on you. The pre-analytical phase and probably the last bit of the post-analytical phase. That two components is dependent on you. So the pre-analytical phase is basically located in the endoscopy or radiological units and general hospital wards, and similarly at the operating theatres. So there's one thing in common in all these aspects, because you are the common factor. When you follow your patients to the radiological unit and to the endoscopy unit, and at the same time at other places where your patient is being investigated, you are there. And obviously in the clinical setup, you are the person who will be there at most of the times. So it may be the nurses who are collecting the samples, but it doesn't matter because you will be there at all the times to supervise them. So you are the common factor. That is why the pathologists have interest on you to make you correct at this point. How can the interns help in improving laboratory services? This is the main concern of today's pathologists. So, as I told you, the decision making to investigate a patient is a crucial thing, because most of the investigations are invasive investigations, at least minimally invasive investigations. So, clinical history is a must, and examination findings, and after that you should arrive at a differential diagnosis. Then you have to choose the most appropriate and most essential investigations, as Dr. Hewage has already highlighted. Then this clinical decision making process starts from you. So the ultimate person who takes the decision may be the consultant, but you are the person who is initiating the process. And this is the most important slide of this session, because your work is coming to our laboratories with this request form. So filling of the request form, which is a legal necessity as well, is very, very essential. So I agree that this form has been invented far back in 1960s, and it may not have been updated for several decades, but most of the essential components are still here. So it is your duty to fill all the components, all the components. The sample name, you have to mention it there. Sample mean you are mentioning the sample name. It is very essential to name the sample correctly with proper spellings. Sometimes, about 1 year back, usually we, as histopathologist, we come across gallbladders. One gallbladder was not, meaning the usual gallbladder you find. It is the gall, gall, that sort of gallbladder. And few weeks after that, I was fortunate enough to have a gallbladder. That means G-O-L-D. So I took the scissor and cut open the gallbladder to see whether there's gold inside. So this is the situation of today's clinical practice, which is reflected by our interns. I am sure that thing has not been written by a nurse, because they are not writing, sample names there. It must have been written by some busy intern medical officer. So you have to mention the date, the signature, and your designation. After that, the patient details will come, the name, the age, the BHT, name and the sex, and the BHT, and the ward. After that, you have to write the history and the differential diagnosis. So most of the things will be mentioned here in the booklet, which you will be able to get during your lunch interval. And what is the information lacking here? So that is the question I'm going to ask. I don't think that it is very clear to you, but I will tell what has been already written there. The sample name has been written as the uterus, and all the details, the house officer, signature, and the dates, all are there. And the patient's name, and the BHT number, and the ward. And age is also there as 55. But it has not been mentioned whether it's a male or a female. So somebody, you can get up and tell me, today pathologists, they don't know that the uterus, it's a usual organ of a female. Males are not supposed to have a uterus. So I thought in that way and understood that these components are not there. Male, female, any past history, relevant examination findings, and no investigation findings as well. When you are sending a uterus, do you know what is the, basic investigation finding we need? If you have investigated the patient, the endometrial thickness is what is required to us. Endometrial thickness. Because the endometrium is the place where you get most of the pathologies. So please mention the endometrial thickness. So we'll go to the next one. All the details are there. If you can read the type of the specimen, it is the foreskin of the prepuce. Can somebody tell me what is the foreskin of the prepuce? I thought, being a pathologist and not being a clinician, it must be the most front part of the prepuce. So we'll go to the next part. Can you see the sex of the patient? It's a female, right? So this is the first time in the history. And the circumcision has been done for phimosis since birth. So this is a very bizarre situation. Don't create such situations in the future. And patient preparation and timing is of the investigation is very essential, and it will be done by you. And proper instructions should be given to the patient prior to sample taking. and preparation, whether the patient has to be on fasting, and when is the investigation, blood or whatever the sample is supposed to take, you have to do all these to the patient. So this is totally done by you. So there's a saying that the report will be as good as the sample you provide. So if you provide a bad sample, you can't expect a good report from us. So this is the reason, if you don't instruct the patient to be on fasting for the particular time period, the patient blood won't reflect the expected result. So you have to be responsible for patient preparation and giving necessary instructions to the patient. After that sample collection, the standard procedure has to be followed, and the sample should be ordered and collected from the correct person. In today's, words, we may be having a lot of Mr. Pereiras, lot of Mr. Silvas, and lot of Mr. Fernandos. So don't write one single, word to identify a patient. When you are ordering an investigation to a patient, you have to go through at least three different identification features. So at the time of report, sample collection also, you have to follow the same way. You have to see the BHT, the name, and some other feature to see whether you are collecting and ordering the samples from the correct person. Otherwise, we will be reporting, sending a report based on the findings which you have sent us to a wrong patient. And this is the other situation. When you do provide us histological samples, it is in the fresh state. It is not fixed. So as graduates, medical graduates, you know how to send a sample to us for pathological testing. You know that it should be sent in formal saline. Do you know the volume which has to be provided? At least 10 times the volume of the sample. And the container should have enough space to put this 10 times volume. But it is very unfortunate to notice that you intern medical officers and the other your colleagues are sending us samples in the situation shown here. Some of you squeeze the sample into the bottles, and when it is in the partially fixed state, we can't take the sample out because it is very rigid. So we have to break the bottles. Or sometimes you quite often use the paracetamol bottles, so we have to cut the bottle with a scissor. And sometimes we damage the sample also. So it is your responsibility when a sample is sent from a, maybe from an endoscopy unit, maybe from a theater, you should be there instructing the nurses to provide adequate space. The bottle, the container should have adequate space to have 10 times the volume of the sample, formal saline. It is not saline, it is not formalin, it is formal saline. Sometimes we see the samples which have been sent in saline because, maybe depending on the knowledge of the nurses, but you are also responsible for that because you are the person who is at the time of collection of the sample. And you have to prevent patient mix-ups. And correct patient should be investigated. And filling of the request forms also should be done in front of the patient with your BHT in your hand. Don't collect all the BHTs and go to one station and fill all the request forms. You have to, order investigations at the BHT, and at the same time fill all the request forms in the presence of the patient, and maybe talking to the patient, knowing the ordered investigation is relevant or not. Because there can be mistakes in the session, at the time of the morning ward round, ordering the patient an unnecessary investigation. So you are responsible to recheck it, whether this investigation is really needed to this patient, and you should fill the request forms at that point, so identification of the patient is not a problem. And universal precautions should be followed at all the times. During sample collection, you have to wear gloves and wash your hands before and after taking, and appropriately For some investigation, you may have to wear gowns, and disposal of, sharp items, and wear masks and eye protection whenever necessary. So you have to follow these investigation, universal precautions. Otherwise, you will end up with the problem and at somewhere in your career. At the same time, we have highlighted the necessary points in this booklet. That is to safeguard you, because you have to consider all the patients, samples, including blood and blood products, are infectious. They may contain hepatitis B or HIV or some other bloodborne infection. So you have to be very cautious when you are collecting the specimens. So the other thing you have to do as an intern medical officer is sample prioritization, because all the samples are being taken to the laboratory, are processed and analyzed at the same time. There's no priority in that. So you are the person who should tell us which sample should be given the priority. So the priority will be given at laboratory procedures, at reporting and typing and release of results. In all these steps, the priority will be given. So your responsibility is to mention the urgent, name urgent, the sent word urgent at the top of the request form in a red pen. At the same time, you have to remember, if you make an unnecessary sample urgent, that will be at the expense of most important other investigations. So you have to mention the indication for making a sample urgent. You may have some social issues, like a staff patient sample. In such situations, you have to consider pros and cons of your decision of making a sample urgent. And sample labeling is very important. You have to name, age and BHT and the word, all these aspects should be mentioned in the sample. And the sample should tally, labeling should tally with the request forms. So when you are sending us a sample, you have to make sure the right patient, right specimen with the right request form. And don't send the samples in boxes like this or bags like this. The sample sending should be done in racks, which are covered by, put in a padded box like this, which has been highlighted in the slide here. So never take a sample in your hand at any time, because there can be accidents on your way. You may, have a fall. So what will happen is the sample will be lost and you may also get injured. So at any urgent situation, don't rush to the laboratories with your with the sample in your hand. Please follow the necessary procedure. Take the sample, label it properly, and put it in the container where it is taken to the lab in the proper way. And this is how the report collection is done. Do you know what this is? This is a pigeonhole. But not this pigeonhole, it is like this. Usually the reports are kept in the pigeonholes which have been allocated for the respective wards. But we have seen, we are generating reports with a lot of hard work, but we see a lot of reports have not been collected. Even some samples which have been made urgent by the clinicians have not been collected and lying, in the pigeonholes. Never expect that the pigeons will come and collect this sample, request forms for you, right? And actually, being an intern officer, intern house officer, I have got the experience. Usually, I drop into the laboratory on my way to the ward. So it gives me time to see the results of the lab reports as the first person, in the ward. So I can decide what to do with the lab report, whether to refer that to a senior person or whether to take some advice from somebody. I can decide before the morning ward round. So what will happen is, if you don't know whether a very important report has come to the ward, you will be finding the report at the middle of the ward round of the consultant. So there will be very bad impression on you if you have not taken adequate steps with regards to the report. So please drop in on your way to the ward in the morning to the laboratory to collect reports, or at least send somebody, an attendant or somebody to collect these reports. So it is your responsibility to collect these reports when they have been kept in these pigeon halls, not our responsibility. We have, generated the reports and delivered it to the pigeon halls. I know in some hospitals they deliver the reports to the wards, that is good, but it is not practiced everywhere. And at the same time, at the point when the service is delivered to the patient, the report has come to you and you have to take the decision. Otherwise, the patient won't benefit. So you should know when to be panic. So don't get upset from a report, from any report, and you have to be cautious about the, situations where you should be panic or inform the seniors about this. So it is your responsibility to take the maximum benefit of the lab reports to the patient. And whenever a special test, there are routine tests and special tests, and you have to be taking, dates for the special test needed. And communicating with the lab is very essential, and don't hesitate to contact the laboratory people for your queries on lab reports. And there are situations where samples can be rejected, clotted sample, a hemolyzed sample, improperly collect sample, labeling is inappropriate, histology samples with no formalin saline, formal saline, and too old specimens, and failure to meet volume criteria, and improperly collected. That means don't take samples from a drip arm. When there's an infusion going on, don't take samples from that drip arm, because blood is diluted and the result will be wrong. And at the same time, the leaking tubes are not accepted to the laboratory setup. And there are ministry rules and guidelines. All the guidelines say interns should be aware of the situation, and no samples should be sent to the private labs, and the need for proper filling of investigation. This is mentioned in the Appendix 3 of this booklet. It has been given in detail. So, important tips for survival: keep request forms at your hand when you are doing the morning ward round, and trace your lab reports. Don't wait till the pigeons collect these reports for you. And it is very important to know what is important and what is not important. And get an early date from the laboratory after giving them a call, so it will impress, it will be effective when you can impress your seniors when you get an early date for a patient. And please do not hesitate to contact the lab to get your queries clarified, and please contact MO Pathology, your seniors who are in the labs. So thank you very much and good luck.